This video series is to accompany the Cisco Netacad IT Essentials 7.0 course. This video is Chapter 6, Applied Networking. In Chapter 6, we're going to look at device to network connection and network troubleshooting. 6.1, device to network connection. When we connect two networks, we have to have two network addresses. A MAC address, it's like a fingerprint. It's unique to the devices on the network. You have to have unique addresses. The same way with an IP address, you have to have unique IP addresses unless you're using some type of masking process. So a mailing address is a lot like an IP address. You send a letter to someone, you've got an address, and you're sending it outside your building, outside your home, where a MAC address is used inside your home. So a MAC address format is in hexadecimal. It's two hexadecimal digits separated by hyphens, two hexadecimal digits separated by colons, or four hexadecimal digits separated by periods. The IPv4 address format is 32-bit in dotted decimal notation, and that's something you need to remember. Dotted decimal notation is the way to say that this format is in, dotted decimal. And IPv6 is in 128-bit hexadecimal format, and this is an example of 128-bit in compressed format. This is in the full format, displaying all the zeros and all of the fields. This one down here is what we call a compressed format. When a laptop is moved to a different network, the MAC address stays the same, but the IPv4 and IPv6 addresses do change depending upon the DNS setting or depending upon the settings for that network. A MAC address is a unique number that is part of the network interface card. It does not change unless you do some type of virtual change or virtual setting or something like that, but it's hard-coded to the network card. IP addresses are assigned by the company or internet provider. On Windows, and the same for Linux, and you can go in and show your address by typing ipconfig or ifconfig on Linux. The Windows IP configuration will show you the host name, and this is if you do the slash all command, you'll see all the information about your IP configuration. It'll show you your physical address or your MAC address. It will show you your IPv6 address, your IPv4 address, your subnet mask, and your default gateway. The IPv4 address format, it's two parts of an IP address. You have the network part and the host part. The network part tells the network and the devices what the network portion is, and the host portion is telling the devices and all of the components, all the host and the devices and everything on the network, what devices are actual nodes or host. The subnet mask determines which part of the address is the network part and which part is the host part. The IPv6 address format is in 128-bit hexadecimal, and there's rules to it. You can omit leading zeros, such as 0db8 can be represented as db8. So when we're looking at, let me see, oh, there's not a db8 on here. But like this one right here, we could eliminate the zero out of here and just represent that as a 123. Or we could, on this one here, just represent that as a 1. We could drop off the leading zeros. You cannot drop off the trailing zeros. You can only drop off the leading zeros. You can also omit zero segments using a double colon, but they have to be all next to each other. So I can eliminate this one or these three, but I cannot eliminate both segments. I cannot eliminate this one and this one. So I can do double colon. So like this is an example down here, but I cannot eliminate this zero here. Now we can represent it with just a zero, but we can compress it, but see, you still have to have this zero here, but you can eliminate those three zero right there by just using double colons, but you can't do both of them. Static addressing. Static address information is needed for communication with other networks and the internet. It is a hard-coded IP address and subnet mask. The default gateway address of the router can be hard-coded so that information can be sent to other networks. And the DNS server converts domain names or URLs to IP addresses for easy reachability or remote websites. Usually, if you have it from the DNS server address, it obtains that from the network servers or network services. And if you have the IP address automatically, it will look for a DHCP server. But if you put it in here, it will be hard-coded. Dynamic addressing is where we just leave it automatically. The DHCP server takes care of the IP addressing and the DNS server addressing. Link local IPv4 and IPv6 addresses. An IPv4 device uses that if the device cannot obtain an IPv4 address. Windows will assign a link local address. In IPv6, the device must always have a dynamic or manually configured link local IP address. When you're designing the network, you have to look at the network components and the overall network design. You have to look at the size of your network. You have to look at what devices are going to be connected, how many users are going to connect. Is it a small business? Is it going to grow in the next year? You have to keep that in mind too. So what type of equipment are you going to need? What type of location? And what are distances? And what kind of budget do you have to work with? When you select a network interface card, you have to look at what type of hardware you're using. Can you put wired Ethernet in? Are you too far to be able to run wire? So you have to do wireless Ethernet. Or is your hardware not able to plug in devices into the back of it? Maybe it's a smaller device like a mobile device that has USB on it and you have to use a wireless Ethernet USB adapter. Now, when you're configuring and updating a network interface card, if you're installing a wireless network card, you want to ensure that the antenna is positioned for optimal reachability. Check with the manufacturer to make sure that you are putting that in the right location, that you have the antenna pointed in the right direction. And then you want to use the device manager to view the device driver details. You can expand the network adapters category, right-click on the specific NIC properties, or update the driver. Usually with newer operating systems, the drivers are going to be taken care of. On Linux, it takes a little bit more work to find the right network card and find that. Windows 10 usually takes care of that unless it's an obscure network interface card, but most of them that are in the industry adhere to Windows 10 standards. And then on the Linux side, if you're using Linux, you know how to go in and find the drivers for that as well. Configuring a NIC card. Wireless devices, including the smartphones, also need IP addresses to participate on a wireless network. So if you are connected, you can do auto join, but then you can do the configure IP. Then if you have a hidden network, you have to know the name of the network to put that in, and then you have to, if it's got some type of security, you need to be able to put in the password or the username and password to be able to connect to the network. ICMP is Internet Control Message Protocol. It's used to test connectivity and send control and error messages. The ping command is part of the ICMP. This is one of the most common commands you use when diagnosing network problems. You have the ping command, and then you have all of these different options on here. You can use T to ping a specified host until stopped. If you're on the Linux side, pinging will continue to ping until you stop it. You can resolve addresses to host names. You can record the count of hops. You can force IPv4. You can force IPv6. So there's a lot of different options there when you're testing. The most common thing you do when you're testing the network is you first want to ping home. You want to ping 127.0.0.1. Ping your local home address for IPv4 to check to see if your network card is working. If you get a ping reply from home, which is your local network interface card, then you want to ping your gateway, your default gateway. If you get your default gateway, then you know that you're at least getting network to there. And then you ping somewhere out on the internet to make sure that your host gateway is going through. And that can tell you quickly where your problems might lie in the network being down or not working correctly. When you connect a wired device to the internet, you can connect a small office or home wired network device that you're going to see the plug on the side of the device and you're just going to plug it in. You can connect the other side to the modem. And this is a representation here. You have your desktop. You have to have the wiring to the router, and then the router has to be wired to the broadband modem unless you're using wireless. Now, when you log into the router, you have to usually be physically connected to log into the administrative functions of the router. Usually what I do is I will take my laptop or my device and I will hardwire into the router. You open up a browser and you enter the default IP address of the router, the gateway address, and you can change the default username and password. You always want to do that on new routers. You want to change, those are usually admin and admin, or the username and passwords on default routers. When they come Cisco route, I mean, all routers are usually home routers. When we're talking about home routers, not Cisco high-end routers. We're talking about home routers. The password usually admin and username is admin. So you want to always change that to something different. You want to log in. You want to change the default password. Log in with your new password. You set up your DHCP address range. You can then renew your IP address on your device by typing ipconfig space release and then ipconfig space /renew that will release the IP address information and then reconnect. And then you can change your default IP addresses and log in with the new IP address. For the wireless side, you can view the WLAN defaults, you can change the network mode, you can configure the SSID, you can hide the SSID if you don't want that being broadcast out to the public. It doesn't mean the network's not visible, it just means it's not visible to normal scans. Then you can configure which channel you want to be on if you've got multiple routers in the same area and you put them on different channels so they don't interfere with each other. You set your security mode, you set your encryption type, and then you put your passphrase that the user needs to log in. When you configure a mesh network, the devices work together. You set the you put the settings on one device and they carry on across all the devices. I have a mesh network in my home. I have three different devices, network devices, and they all communicate with each other. Network address translation, or NAT, converts private IPv4 addressing to internet routable public IPv4 addresses. So you can have private network IP addresses, so you can use 192.168.0.1 or 1.1, and then when it gets out to the internet, though, you have to have public routable addresses, and that's what the network address translation does for you. Quality of service is a QoS. It's a service. It's a configuration that allows for prioritization of specific traffic types. So for example, if you know that your IP phone system or service needs to go through over gaming, it's going to put high priority on that, or let's say that you put a higher priority on gaming, so you have that set as high. FTP might be set at medium, and Nutella applications or another type of application might have a low or a medium priority on the network. And it doesn't mean that those are not going to work properly. It just means that when the network data comes through, the network's going to prioritize traffic to give the high priority traffic more. It's going to send that through quicker than it will be the other devices. So it'll hold this up maybe a little bit. IP phone, everything has to go through because remember, it's UDP. If it doesn't get through, it just gets dropped and then you won't be able to make the phone call. So it has to have a high priority. Same thing with video streaming. That has to have a high priority, where FTP works off a TCP. And so it's a connection oriented. And so it can have a lower priority on the network, but it's connected. So the packets are always going to get through. Universal plug and play, or UPNP, is not secure and it's a security risk. However, if you are, or it does allow devices to dynamically add themselves to a wireless network without intervention or configuration, it is a security risk. However, if you're working with the Microsoft Xbox gaming systems and you are working in someone's, you're setting up for a client and they've got, and you're setting up a home system and they have the Xbox services, Microsoft and Xbox still requires the universal plug and play sometimes for it to be able to work properly, some of the Xbox live services. And I've struggled with this in my home personally. My son has to have Xbox gaming services, so I've put him on his own separate router for the U plug and play services to be able to do the live services, and then I lock down the rest of the network in my home just because I don't trust the universal plug and play, and it's not all good to have it always opened up. So you may have to have that opened up though if you're working with a client that needs those services. A DMZ, or a demilitarized zone, it's a military term, but it is in networking. It's a term or a network that provides services to an untrusted network. A DMZ often contains servers. So this is a DMZ here. So you would come through, you would have your home office and the internet, but the traffic would go through the DMZ. So the internet only sees this side. It doesn't see any routers here. And they've got this image set up wrong. This DMZ really should be over here. And some wireless routers do support the creation of a DMZ or a virtual DMZ. And then you can also have a hardware DMZ. Port forwarding. Port forwarding allows traffic to specified ports. Port triggering allows a temporary opening in the firewall to allow data to be specified to an inbound port or a port range for an application or game. So let's say that a certain application needs to get to a certain IP address. The port triggering will open that IP address and those ports so that return traffic, it's trusted at that point. So it knows that it needs to open that up in the firewall. So let's say that you're opening up a gaming service and you're going to be doing a video call or a gaming service, and that video call needs a specified port opened. Well, it's normally closed. The port forwarding will open up that port for that session and then close it down afterwards. Now, MAC address filtering is not commonly used anymore, but it still can be. And the reason it's not common a lot in security is because you can spoof your MAC address. You can use virtual MAC addressing. And so it's not exactly as secure, but it can happen and you need to be aware of it. So MAC address filtering is used to specify the MAC addresses that are allowed on the wireless network. You would have to find the MAC address for each device that you want to be on your network and then physically put that into the router. Now, whitelisting allows users such as children or employees access to a specified IP address only. And blacklisting is known as blocking known websites. So if there's a particular website you don't want someone to go to, you put that into a block list. I like to call it a block list, and then allow list. So I call it allow listing and block listing, but the common term in networking is whitelisting and blacklisting. Now, when we talk about Internet of Things or IoT, you'll hear IoT or Internet of Things. That's kind of hot. It's a hot topic in 2021, 2022. You can connect multiple devices to pre-existing network or a network of its own. Internet of Things describes physical objects or groups of objects that are embedded with sensors, processing ability, software, or other technologies that connect and exchange data with other devices and systems over the internet. An example of that might be a Roomba house cleaner. You may be able to connect with it with your mobile phone and tell it and set it up and tell it when you want it to move around the house. An IoT device might be a refrigerator or a thermostat control in your home to control the temperature. And then you can have remote temperature sensors in the home that send signals to the to that device. You can have all kinds of different IoT devices. Vehicles have IoT devices in them. So that's just the IoT Internet of Things. You'll hear that it's becoming a lot more common. The network troubleshooting process. The network troubleshooting process follows the six steps that we've talked about in previous videos and in previous sessions. We identify the problem, we establish a theory, we test the theory, we establish a plan to resolve the problem, and then implement that plan. We verify system functionality, and then we document our findings. So troubleshooting a network, you want to ask open-ended questions and closed-ended questions. If you want to pause the video right here and look at some of these questions, you can do that. I'm not going to read down through them. But network problems can be simple or they can be multiple complex, and you always want to check the simple things first. Step two, you want to establish a theory, probable cause, some common network problems that you might want to check. Pause the video here if you want to read down through these. Next, you want to test your theory. Here's some common steps to determining causes. You want to then establish a plan of action. Here's some actions that you can take. You want to verify full system functionality. You might want to run the IP config all to make sure that the IP addresses are displaying properly. Maybe use the ping. I always do that whenever I've worked with a network. I always use the ping command to make sure I can ping both the local, the gateway, and then someplace out on the internet. And then you want to document your findings, discuss the solution to implement it that needs to be implemented with the customer, document any components used in the repair, and document the time spent to solve the problem. Here's some more common problems that you might run across. You can pause the video here and read across these. Here's some advanced problems and solutions that you might come across. Here's some more advanced problems and solutions for FTP and secure internet connections. These are advanced problems and solutions using network tools.